my car, see you on TV. Sunset done changed ever since we was on. I dreamed it all ever since I was young. They said I won't be nothing. Now they always say congratulations.
Congratulations.
Worked so hard, forgot how to vacation. They ain't never had the dedication. People hating, say we changing, look, we made it. Yeah, we made it.
Yeah, oh, I was patient. Hey, oh. Now I can scream that we made it.
We made it.
Now everywhere I go, they say congratulations. Young graduation.
Yeah.
I pick up the rock and I ball, baby.
Ball.
I'm looking for someone to call, baby. But right now I got a situation. Never old Ben Franklin.
Cash.
Big rings,
champagne.
My life is like a ball game. But instead I'm in a trap, though. Paso big, call it Super Bowl.
Super Bowl,
caught up. Get in the rows. Top flow lifestyle.
Top.
Hacho and Post.
Yeah.
Malone. I got a play on my phone. You know what I'm on. Hacho Houdini is gone.
My mama call, see you on TV. Sunset done changed ever since we was on. I dreamed it all ever since I was young. They said I won't be nothing. Now they always say congratulations. Worked so hard, forgot how to vacation. They ain't never had the dedication. People hating, say we changing, look, we made it. Yeah, we made it.
Buenas tardes. Bienvenidos al Festival de Otoño de Capstone, proyectos finales de la Escuela de Humanidades y Comunicación 2019. Mi nombre es Patricia Cruz y seré su maestra de ceremonias en español.
Good afternoon. Welcome to the School of Humanities and Communication Fall 2019 Capstone Festival. My name is Angela Daly and I will serve as the English speaking master of ceremonies.
Les queremos agradecer a los estudiantes, familiares y amigos que nos acompañan el día de hoy. Igualmente, deseamos agradecer a todos los profesores y el personal de la Universidad Estatal de la Bahía de Monterrey por su compromiso a la visión de la universidad.
Now, we would like to thank the students, families, and friends who have joined us today. Equally so, we wish to thank the faculty and staff of the California State University, Monterey Bay, for their commitment to the CSUMB vision.
Los proyectos de Capstone que ustedes verán hoy reflejan el trabajo de los estudiantes del programa de Humanidades y Comunicación y su concentración en varias áreas de estudio. Estos proyectos representan nuestro trabajo y esfuerzo para traer a la luz temas de gran interés para cada uno de nosotros. Además, los proyectos muestran nuestro crecimiento intelectual y personal, donde reflejan el apoyo de nuestros profesores.
The capstone projects you will see today reflect the work of the students majoring in humanities and communication with a concentration in a number of studies. They are a representation of our hard work and effort to bring to light the issues we are passionate about. These projects represent our intellectual and personal growth and reflect the support of our professors.
Este año tenemos dos secciones del curso de Capstone. Cada sección se ha dedicado a explorar una temática en particular. El primer tema es trauma y curación, dirigido por el Dr. Ernest Stromberg. El segundo tema es crisis y oportunidad, cultura y comunidad, dirigido por el Dr. Phuong Nguyen. Los estudiantes han tenido la opción de explorar en estos temas a través de las siguientes modalidades: haciendo un trabajo de investigación, participando en una práctica profesional o realizando un proyecto creativo.
This year we have two sections of our senior capstone course. Each section has devoted its efforts to explore a particular theme. The first theme is healing and trauma, led by Dr. Ernest Stromberg. The second theme is crisis and opportunity, culture and community, led by Dr. Phuong Nguyen. Students in each section have been led to explore these themes by working on any of the following options: a research paper, an internship, or a creative project.
Nuestro festival incluye una variedad de proyectos y una galería de pósters donde ustedes podrán apreciar los trabajos y hablar con los estudiantes sobre sus experiencias. Algunos estudiantes de cada clase fueron seleccionados para presentar una muestra representativa de proyectos de su clase. Estas presentaciones proveerán más información sobre el tema que su clase exploró.
Today's festival showcases a variety of projects presented in a poster gallery, where you can appreciate them and also interact with the scholars about their experiences. Students from each capstone section were selected to orally present a representative sampling of projects from their class. These presentations will provide further insight into the theme their class explored.
Y ahora nos gustaría invitar a la directora de la Escuela de Humanidades y Comunicación, la doctora Sam Robinson, para darle la bienvenida al Festival de Otoño de Capstone 2019.
And now we would like to invite the chair for the School of Humanities and Communication, Dr. Sam Robinson, to personally welcome you to the Fall 2019 Capstone Festival.
Hello. Well, welcome. I'm so happy to see a lot of familiar faces out here. And on behalf of the School of Humanities and Communication, I just want to tell you congratulations. It's been a lot of hard work, but you did it, and you're here, and it's almost winter break. Yay. I know we're all looking forward to that. And again, just how proud we all are of you, that you have had to overcome a lot of obstacles to get here, but you did it. You're still standing. We look forward to hearing the presentations and looking at the posters and to celebrating with you, with your friends and your family here today. This semester in particular, I feel like the theme has been overcoming obstacles. We've all had a lot of obstacles to deal with this semester, but we've done it. We've done it as a team, as a School of Humanities and Communication, and I'm really proud of all of us for that. I really want to thank our Capstone faculty, Professors Nguyen and Stromberg, for all of their great work in helping get this together. Could you guys help me give them a round of applause? I also want to give a very special thank you. You maybe can't see them because, well, I'm not sure where Imani went, but behind the curtain over here, we have some extraordinary student workers. Imani Rashid and Isabel Lopez, they are the rock stars of Capstone and all things HCOM. So if we could give them a round of applause for all the work that they've done. Well, I know we're all anxious to get to it. So again, I'm so proud of you. Congratulations, and I wish you the very best for your future.
Gracias, doctora Robinson, por sus palabras de bienvenida. Y ahora vamos a introducir a los presentadores que fueron seleccionados de cada clase.
Thank you, Dr. Robinson, for your welcome. And now we would like to begin with the oral presentations prepared by the selected presenters from each section.
Por favor, tengan en cuenta que algunos de los temas presentados hoy incluyen discusiones sobre eventos y experiencias traumáticas, incluyendo abuso sexual, físico y estrés postraumático.
Please be advised that some of the topics presented today will involve discussions of traumatizing events and experiences, including sexual and physical abuse and PTSD.
A continuación, demos la bienvenida a nuestros presentadores del tema trauma y curación.
And now, please join us in welcoming our first presenters to the stage and representing the theme, Trauma and Healing, Shelby Leal.
Hello, my name is Shelby Leal, and I did my research on the intergenerational trauma of Native communities and the process of healing. So currently, Native Americans face significantly higher rates of health and wellness challenges. These include socioeconomic disparities, interpersonal violence, substance abuse, and mental health issues. The historic rhetoric surrounding these disparities has often been that these communities are just genetically inclined to these problems. However, we are now understanding that a link exists between mental health and intergenerational trauma. I wanted to understand what this meant and then investigate the traumas both historically and presently. I found that the brutality, land dispossession, and eradication of culture, which includes loss of land, loss of family members, and tribes and traditions, are inherently part of the trauma felt by these communities. Native American social worker and mental health expert, Dr. Maria Yellow Horse Braveheart, gives a definition of historical trauma. She states that it is the cumulative emotional and psychological wounding over one's lifetime and from generation to generation following the loss of lives, land, and vital aspects of culture. I spent a lot of time researching the history of boarding schools, forced assimilation, mass genocide, and land theft, which led me to my primary focus of legal injuries in the lives of Native Americans. This showed up in the form of broken treaties in regards to land rights and use. This leads me to the video, which I have, that shows a time-lapse vision of how much Native land has been stolen between 1776 and 2010. As the blue homelands disappear, small red areas appear, indicating the establishment of reservations. This video reflects the majority of my research, which was looking at the use of government legal power in their attempts to eradicate Native culture. The imperialistic relationship between the United States and Native Americans is far more involved than just the removal and assimilation practices of the past. I found that the integration of relocation and consolidation is done primarily by breaking treaties, and now their subjugation becomes less visible in modern America, as is often seen in the way our structurally violent and racist systems work throughout our government. The United States almost exclusively relies now on breaking treaties or creating policies that require no more than a consultation with Native Americans before enforcing these harmful policies. I concluded my research by claiming that the United States' past attempts to erase self-identity and land cession increases the importance and timeliness in giving back the land and power to Native people. The process of healing rests in dismantling the boundaries and borders of history and stereotypes that our society has become so closely accustomed to over centuries of settlement and broken treaties. Healing means giving power back to the voices that have been buried in our history and recognizing the importance of self-determination and sovereignty in Native American communities. Thank you. Our next presenter is Stephanie Rodriguez.
Hello, my name is Stephanie Rodriguez. The title of my research paper is The Healing Process Post-Childhood Molestation Trauma. I wrote the paper in a hybrid memoir and research format due to wanting to tell my own story about my experience with childhood molestation. I wanted to back up my struggles with research. This is a way for me to tell my story, to heal, but also to know that I am not alone. Bringing awareness to this topic with factual information and show that this is still an ongoing problem. On my next slide, as you could see, childhood molestation causes many negative after effects, such as PTSD, trust issues, depression, anxiety, and loss of memory. These are some issues that I have gone through in my personal life and that I'm still fighting till this day. It is necessary to heal from this traumatic experience to live a normal, healthy life. Some ways of healing that I have researched and done myself are attending therapy and writing about one's past. With therapy, survivors can start to heal and it stops a harmful cycle because hurt people hurt people. It is important to heal, to get help needed, because that will make you regain the power that was once lost in a healthy way. On my next slide, you could see some of the statistics I found. In the research article, Therapy Groups for Women Sexually Molested as Children, written by Mavis and Wagner, it states that an annual occurrence of reported child sexual abuse is at 100,000 cases. This phenomenon is largely unreported. As a result, the hidden incident may be anywhere from 5 to 10 times greater than was reported. And approximately 80% of sex crimes against children occur with immediate family, relatives, close friends, or neighbors. I was molested when I was 6 years old, and I didn't come out to authorities till I was the age of 21. Now I'm going to read a little piece of my memoir from my paper about how I felt when I was 23 years old and I found out that the judge decision on my case. The official trial lasted 2 weeks. The man who sexually assaulted me and had prior convictions of sexual assault of a minor and domestic violence. Even when the assaulter had prior convictions and I had a clean record, the man who sexually abused me won the trial. He was given a slap on the wrist, and the only punishment he got was to register on the sex offenders list. This broke my heart, not only because I lost, but also because he will continue to hurt innocent children and put them through what he put me. I told myself if he could go to jail, I would be saving at least one little girl. I was angry and shocked that the jury let a man who had previously gone to trial for molesting another little girl, apart from me, walk free. The rape abuse and set national network known as RAIN states that out of every 1,000 instances of sexual abuse, only 13 cases get referred to prosecutors, and only 7 cases lead to felony convictions. As a society, we need to make sure that sexual assault is taken more seriously and make sure that through the legal system, predators are not walking free because they will continue to hurt innocent children. For me, this research paper was a step closer to heal. It was therapeutic. I'm a survivor of childhood molestation, but also survivor of life because it taught me that I can handle anything that life throws at me. I can turn a bad situation into a learning lesson and grow from it. I don't know if I will ever be 100% healed, but I do know that I'm not giving up on living a healthy, happy life. Thank you. Now I would like to present the next speaker, Trevor Nicholson.
Hi, I'm Trevor Nicholson. This is Gilroy Strong, a podcast that explores the effects of trauma and the current state of healing in my hometown of Gilroy. As many of you probably know, Gilroy's annual Garlic Festival was one of the latest in a seemingly endless line of gun violence. 3 dead, 17 wounded, a massive blow to a festival that is symbolic of everything my city has to offer. In the aftermath, all I saw was pain. People were hurting and confused, and the city no longer felt safe. I struggled to make sense of things, buried underneath cynicism, assuming that the Garlic Festival shooting had destroyed the community that I've called home for my entire life. And that's where this podcast comes in. I was inspired by the USC Shoah Foundation, which has been collecting video testimonials from genocide survivors since its inception in 1994. I wanted to provide a recorded account from Gilroy residents about the city in the aftermath of tragedy. But I didn't want this podcast to feel so heavy. I wanted to focus on the pockets of light that exist amidst the darkness, and I wanted to do it in a way that felt compelling to listen to. I owe a lot to WNYC's Radio Lab podcast. Their focus on the journalistic process, primarily on conducting interviews, was a huge inspiration to the tone and voice of Gilroy Strong. For this project, I interviewed 3 people. My younger sister, Skylar, a local elementary school teacher, Soquel, and a staff member at a local church, Morgan. Through these conversations, I learned so much about the healing process in areas of my city that I never would have seen without these people. My conversation with Skylar taught me so much about high schoolers' reactions to tragedy. What particularly stuck out to me was that students at her school and at their crosstown rival had dropped all semblance of petty rivalry in order to set up spaces for people to talk and to process their feelings, as well as organizing fundraisers for fellow students who'd been injured in the shooting. So Kel had a really interesting take on healing. By watching the way her kindergarten students lived their lives, she found a way to recover some of that childlike wonder and live her life in a way that didn't let trauma take away the joy that she can find in the little things. But above all, each person I interviewed shared a common cause of their healing: talking. And that's why I believe this podcast matters. I wanted to provide people a platform to speak where they could be certain that someone was listening. By giving people the power to tell their own stories, they're able to work through trauma in a way that they might not be able to in their day-to-day lives. So I encourage you, no matter what you've been through, to find a way to tell your story, because your voice matters. Thank you. So please join me in welcoming George Worthy to the stage.
Hello, good afternoon. Thanks for coming. My name is George Worthy, and I have PTSD. Have you ever cried out when you were awakened from a bad dream? You remember that you were having a flashback memory. One where there are very painful memories of war. Or you're walking down a dark street and suddenly nothing seems familiar. Fear starts to overwhelm you, and you're almost afraid to move. And then you remember the screams, confusion, dirt, noise, blood, the dead you will never forget. These are the sights and sounds of war. That's where my PTSD came from. It's an insidious disease, and it strikes every victim differently. If I seem mixed up and unsure of myself, that's just another way PTSD affects me. I don't like going to a loud movie. I've had all the loud noises I can stand. Packed venues are avoided, and often I am behind on my homework because I would be typing along and look up a fact from the internet, and I'm reminded of a terrible incident where I was terrified. It overwhelms me, and I have to get up and walk around and find something until my wife sees that I need her touch. Your radio operator, and you just share a laugh and a meal. He sets off a booby trap and disappears into the confusion of dirt, noise, and blood. The sight of body parts is a true trauma that never leaves you. Things like that happen when humans make instruments of war a child can use. I describe PTSD as the wound that never healed. It has been known by many names over the 2,000 years it has been identified. Once diagnosed, you'll find a lot of things you take for granted will be denied to you because of your terrible memories. The majority of people that are struck by PTSD have no idea they are wounded. They do not know why they feel as they do. Researchers at the National Institute of Mental Health have found there is a direct correlation between the sight of fellow soldiers being killed and the survivors being overwhelmed with PTSD. There are no common symptoms in all PTSD cases. I served 3 years of combat in Vietnam, and I didn't see death daily, but I saw it often. I've suffered the debilitating grip of PTSD for over 35 years. My life has been filled with poor examples of my own actions during a depressive state. Had it not been for my wife of 30 years, I would not be here today. When in the grips of an episode, you often feel like ending it all would be the best way to go. Lorraine was my staff, my nurse, my reason to live. She held me one night and told me that I had to get some help. This was after a marathon of crying that she told me I had to get help. So I am very proud of my family. I'm proud of the things that they went through for me. My wife explained to the kids as soon as they could understand why I did the things that they witnessed. They stand at my side and are proud of me and of my service. I was helped by their love, but there are many victims that still suffer in silence. The Veterans Administration is trying to help. They are trying to catch up. During the Vietnam War, between 1955 and 1975, there were 2.5 million soldiers, sailors, and airmen called to a country so far away they had no idea where they were going, and then 58,300 of them were killed. There are roughly 160,000 Vietnam veterans left, still alive, and most of them have PTSD. 22 veterans die every week of the year, and most of them by their own hand. There are still thousands who are homeless and addicted to drugs and alcohol. They are everywhere. They are our brothers and sisters. They paid for our freedoms, and then they were ignored. I see them at the VA clinic, and they are suffering still from Vietnam. My mom used to say, God works in mysterious ways. And she was right. Just as I needed help so desperately, God sent Lorraine, my wife, to care for me. I tell her, no one can beat two people. It's just having someone that loves you and believes in you. I know that there's no way I can say or express by words, either written or spoken, what it means to me to know that I'll never have to face another episode alone. Thank you. The next speaker is Elena.
My name is Elena Jolene, and I'm going to be talking briefly about my creative project. As most of you know, the theme for my section's course is trauma and healing. So for this project, I decided to write a fictionalized short story detailing a young woman's multiple encounters with trauma. This is a story that deals with sexual assault, childhood abuse, mental illness, and the overall perpetual abuse of women. Furthermore, through this story, I aim to explore how this young woman uses the form of writing as an outlet to begin to heal from these traumatic experiences. Some goals I had in completing this project were to shed light on these social issues and to invoke change. I want people to read my story and to say, this isn't right, and ask, how do we change this? Furthermore, through this story, I want to connect with people who have endured similar experiences. I want these people to take comfort in knowing that they aren't alone in their suffering, and to use this as a motivator to begin to heal. In exploring our class theme through the project, I've learned that the role that writing plays in the healing from traumatic experiences, how we are connected through our shared experiences, and through writing and voicing these experiences, we are able to heal together. Now, I'm going to read a small fragment from my piece. I don't know why I came back every time. The cycle continues. Maybe we go back because we think we have nowhere else to go. We go back because somehow that one moment of temporary satisfaction surpasses the 10 instances of degradation, danger, hopelessness. We go back because we are comfortable, comfortable in our state of stillness, because a state of misery is better than no living state at all. We go back, we meet you again, because it's all we've ever known. Since we were children. So when we became adults, when we became women, they controlled our bodies, our minds, our ability to dream of a place of freedom. We've been traumatized. Again and again we meet, but no more. You can try to silence us, but you will fail. You may destroy us to our core. Of this, we may have no control. But we will recover. We will find ourselves again. We will speak. We will heal. This, you can never take from us. Thank you.
En este momento, les invitamos a que pasen a la galería de pósters para conversar con los estudiantes sobre sus trabajos. En este receso, ustedes podrán disfrutar de bocadillos y regresaremos para las siguientes presentaciones a las 3:10. A continuación, en la siguiente sesión, vamos a escuchar a algunos de los estudiantes, entre ellos es Maggie, Yesenia, Madison, Brandon y Osman.
We now invite you to view the poster displays, enjoy the refreshments, and to take time to talk to the graduating scholars.
My name is Nick Cafiro, and I did a presentation called Marketing with Movements, which is analysis of
corporate and social media and grassroots marketing campaigns. And so a lot of the time when people think about viral campaigns, they think there's an element to it that has to do with some spontaneous idea that sort of is in the right time in the right place. But there's more to that process. So when you have a social media campaign, a lot of the times there's a corporate element that goes into it that is very well thought out. And I wanted to analyze that so when you have something like a social movement, a grassroots campaign, they can borrow those strategies to sort of enhance their own social movement campaigns. And that's essentially the gist of what my paper's about.
Teacher shortage has been ongoing for a few years. There's not a specific date which it goes back to. However, the 2008 recession in California is a great place where this had started. I did interviews with around 10 teachers local within the Monterey County. And from these interviews, I have found out that being a teacher is hard, essentially. A lot gets put on the blame for them, but there's a lot more that goes on behind that. The district plays a big part in their effectiveness as a teacher. The district is their form of support, and they really need that support. But however, many of them felt that they did not receive the support that they needed. One solution to teacher shortage that they proposed to me was implementing affordable housing. This would be done by districts and, if possible, by the state. However, many opposed to this because they fear that the market value of houses will decrease. So there's a lot of opposition in the community to this proposal. However, it's still something that they're pushing forward. Within the next decade, for 2020 and forward, it's projected that there will be a shortage of around 100,000 teacher shortages in California that spreads throughout the state.
Hi, my name is Patricia, and my project is Making It Dope, the Latinx community that keeps growing. I did three parts of my project. The first phase was to learn about the Latinx term. I know not a lot of people know about the term Latinx, and so I provided the term, but also within the Latinx community, the Hispanic community. How do they know this term? Surprisingly, not a lot of people really know the term, and it's important because for the marketing community, it's important to teach people about this community. Some of this is the data, and the last part is a deliverable, a PSA, in where it talks a little bit more about influencers and what they identify themselves as, their nationality, and what they would like to be called, Latinas, Latinos, Latinx. And this is very important because brands in the U.S. need to learn how to market appropriately, cultural relevant and cultural authentic.
My name is Katie Puentes, and I did a creative piece this semester for my capstone. I went ahead and wrote a novel entitled Filosofia, Coming Out Proud in a Homophobic World. It's an autobiographical nonfiction piece which explores my coming out story and understanding and navigating my way through and understanding my own sexuality while facing factors of internal homophobia and external homophobia, whether it be from family, peers, friends. That's pretty much what I did my project on.
Savannah McKillop, and my project is Dissembling Urban Ideology. So food waste is a huge issue here in the United States, and it's continuing to increase. I have a chart right here that is from a 2009 study from the Aggressive Increase of Food Waste in America and its Environmental Impact, basically saying that the human obesity rate is increasing along with food production increase, and along with that is the greenhouse gases from landfill emissions are increasing, so everything is correlating with each other. But my main research question was, are urban cities the main area for food waste? And so what I did is that I came up with a couple interview questions to interview 11 food consumers and producers here locally and also in different states, all from urban cities, so that I can get a feel for what their opinions are on food waste in their area and what they do. Basically I have my research question, food consumer interview questions, and the producer and consumer, because I had to ask different questions because producers are going to have different responses for if their restaurants create compost or not. And basically in my overall results that 9 out of the did anything about it. Two of them had known to compost because it was already provided for them for where they live. So first off, it's kind of a troubled issue that most places don't even provide compost in not even your neighborhood, but in restaurants. And also, the biggest urban cities in America, Nashville, Denver, New York City, have high rates of food waste in restaurants and at home waste. And most of my interview questions revolved around that and basically resulted in most food waste was at home. So people feel pressured to go and eat outside, and then they take their leftovers home, and then the food that they had saved or had they had bought from stores were wasted. And that was another issue, an aspect of my paper, is how Americans tend to buy in bulk and how it's just increasing. And I wanted this problem to be kind of brought awareness to, because not only is the food waste increasing and making our landfills larger, but it's releasing methane, which is like the 0.7% of the greenhouse gases invading the atmosphere. And also humans waste up to $250,000 yearly on food waste. So major loss in finance and an increase in global warming.
So my project is the need for ethnic studies in all California high schools. So about 50%, over 50% of California public high school students identify as Latino or Hispanic. However, very few know about the Mexican-American war, along with the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo. Studies have shown that students of color, as well as white, have benefited from ethnic studies. And this is essential for California legislators to make ethnic studies a required course across the state.
Holden Guckenberg?
Tell us about your project.
I interviewed like 7 people about their trauma that they face, and they're queer people, and then I wrote their story based on what they told me about their experiences with trauma, and like in a creative way, and made it my own story, but also their story, to like to share what LGBTQ people go through.
Okay, hi, my name is Amin, and my project is about bulletproof backpacks, not the solution. We noticed that recently a lot of shootings have been happening in our country, and we want to make sure that all the kids that go to school are very safe. So my project is basically trying to state the fact that these bulletproof backpacks that they are selling in the market are not the ultimate solution, and we need to look for other solutions in order to protect our kids from this gun violence. Thank you.
My name is Krista Baines. I'm an ESMP major. My topic's on bullying. It's really just about how to get a set concept in the classroom so that kids feel safe in the classroom. I want to be a teacher, so I feel like this is the best way is to educate the kids about bullying and help prevent it. And that's my.
My name is Alyssa Riley, and I did my presentation on my mom, and I interviewed her about the trauma and grief she experienced while losing her 2 older brothers. And this is a joint project of both research and creative. So I did research over the trauma and grief of people losing siblings, and then I wrote a poem based on my mom's experience after conducting the interview. So.
Hello, my name is Elena. My project on the African-American community in Seaside. Originally it was going to be on gentrification, but it came to my attention that the African-American community was once a very unique and thriving community in the Seaside area, and they had a lot to do with how Seaside became a city in the first place.
Hi, my name is Breda Fuentes. I am a practical professional ethics concentration, and my capstone is a collection of 9 poems that tackle the stigma of mental health within the Latinx community. I write poems about the past, present, and future. I conducted 8 interviews and created testimonial research, and based on that, I wrote my poems.
Hi,
Hi there, my name is Andrew White. I did my capstone project on dismantling homelessness in Monterey County. So my angle here is that there is a general population that we normally refer to when we think of homelessness, and that's the chronic homelessness. However, there are a big population that goes outside of those bounds. And in that population, 38% are not in touch with government services. My opinion is that if we start to put our efforts into getting people identifications or identification documents and the things that baseline you need in order to get in touch with a program that's designed to help, we will make a much bigger impact than we have been so far. So that's my idea. Thank you for listening.
Y ahora damos la bienvenida a los siguientes presentadores del tema Crisis y Oportunidad, Cultura y Comunidad.
And now, please join us in welcoming our second set of presenters to the stage and representing the theme, Crisis and Opportunity, Culture and Community, Margaret Allen Young.
Hi there. Hi, my name is Maggie Allen Young, and my project is called Hashtag Queer Community, Communication, and Identity in the Digital Age. So the creation and facilitation of community among LGBTQ people has always been necessary as a means of support, protection, and affirmation in a discriminatory society. This has traditionally been found in urban meccas like San Francisco and New York. However, the advent of new technology has allowed for community building and organizing to occur more easily without face-to-face contact. In this project, I utilized existing literature, including a large study on queer rural populations by the Movement Advancement Project and real-world examples to explore the evolution of the digital queer community. The initial stages of this project involved contextualizing the history of the LGBTQ movement to determine why the internet has come to hold such a place of importance as a platform for building community and exploring sexual and gender identity. What I found was that for a community that had already become adept at utilizing media for activism, the internet provided another space for organization and broadcasting of vital information. As early as the mid-90s, websites focused on LGBTQ life began to appear, providing a space for activism, escape, and support. As the internet continued to develop, many younger queer people who found themselves isolated geographically or culturally attested to its usefulness as a tool for exploration and connection. It has been a platform where voices that might not have been heard otherwise can speak, and unique projects such as Queering the Map can come to exist because of the tools that the internet provides us. A specific example of an internet community that I focused on was the social media microblogging platform Tumblr, which served as a central hub for online queer communities from its establishment in 2007 up until very recently when policy changes sent many users away from the platform. This brings me to another important aspect of online communities that might not be initially obvious. They are, by their very nature, siloed and unstable. Physical needs cannot be met solely by digital means, a fact which I also explored through investigating the establishment and criticism of the It Gets Better project. This brings me to the three major conclusions I came to in this project, which I've listed here on the slide behind me. The first being that technology and the internet has dramatically changed what it means to be queer in the modern world and likely will continue to do so for the foreseeable future. The second is that the historical trajectory and needs of the LGBTQ community made the internet especially suitable for community building and identity affirmation. And finally, that this move towards the virtual has created a clear divide between on and offline LGBTQ communities that is yet to be reconciled entirely. Thank you. I'd now like to introduce our next speaker, Yesenia Hernandez.
Good afternoon, friends and family. My name is Yesenia Hernandez, and my project is a research essay named Autism in the Latino Community. The idea for my project came from working with a Latina autistic student, and my research focuses in my community of Greenfield, California, Monterey County. When I thought about our class theme, Crisis and Opportunity, Culture and Community, I immediately thought about my student and other children living in Greenfield. I began to examine my student and her parents and noticed various barriers that existed between her parents and the school district. Outside therapists, relationships with their acquaintances, and other relationships with parents at the school their daughter attends. What captured my attention was her parents' discussion of their daughter's neurodiversity. I started to question why this existed in the Latino community. It's no secret to most, Latinos do not like to face differences, so they often go ignored. The purpose of my project aimed to explore the barriers in the community and to study underlying reasons why Latino children are diagnosed with autism at a much later age than non-Latino children. We know that since the beginning of the 21st century, a rise of autism diagnoses arose, but the question was why? The reason was that we were beginning to understand what autism was and were able to label it as such. Unfortunately, the Latino community fell behind in understanding autism and ignored the signs. In my research, I learned that there are stigmas in the Latino community that suppress the understanding of our Latino parents because they fear el que dirán, what will they say? They also lack resources that are not available to them because they live in a rural area with very limited resources. We are part of Monterey County, but we are not Monterey. The population of Greenfield is 17,000 people, most of which are immigrant field workers. Most of our families are from Oaxaca, Zacatecas, and a variety of small rural towns in Mexico. Our parents do not speak English. Some cannot communicate in Spanish because they only know their native language. As we move forward with the objective of our Latino autism community, we can continue to improve the qualities of our services to parents and allies who require it and are willing to be receptive to neurodiversity. We plan to bring resources, anecdotes, and support services to our families, and by doing so, we hope to break the barriers caused by stigmas that have been embedded by generations. We would like to bring a more inclusive connection with neurodiversity children, their families, and our community. I believe that the children, as well as their families, can benefit from the inclusivity that we can bring to them by encouraging dialogue and sincerity through numerous resources with the purpose of our children becoming more successful in their education. Thank you. I now present to you Madison Randozo.
Hi everyone, my name is Madison Randozo. I completed a creative project aligned with our course theme of crisis and opportunity. It was informed and inspired by the passing of my former boyfriend, Matt, last spring. Matt's death was sudden and heartbreaking. Earlier this year, addiction took his life. My project titled The Letters I Never Wrote chronicles specific events, emotions, and periods of time over the past 7 years of my life written in the form of letters. The motivation for this project comes from my strong desire to shed light on a side of addiction not often talked about. It is challenging to be in a relationship with someone suffering with addiction, and it is devastating to watch the cyclical nature of the disease, especially when you don't understand it. Here's an excerpt from one of my letters. Dear reader, have you ever loved someone so much that it hurt? Have you ever wanted to fix someone? If so, did you succeed? Everyone always says you can't fix someone unless they want to fix themselves. And there is so much truth in that, except that we still try. We are self-centered, thinking that we can change someone so broken, and in the process, we end up hurting ourselves. Have you ever been in love? Maybe you have been, but you weren't sure. Or you were, but didn't tell anyone. Or, like me, you convince yourself that you weren't, so it doesn't hurt so bad. Love is a funny emotion to try and work through. It is confusing, but simple at the same time. In February, someone I love passed away. Addiction took his life slowly, then all at once. Addiction is something that confuses many. Some just can't grasp it. It too is confusing, but simple at the same time. We don't know why someone just can't stop. What makes you do it? What makes you want it? 7 years ago, my life changed because of the opioid crisis, and 7 months ago, it changed again. 4 years of my life were caught in a whirlwind of love and toxicity. It was a relationship just like any other 16-year-old, filled with lies and denial and forgiveness. I finally let go of it a few years ago, and with it went a piece of my heart. I was so sad for this person that I loved so deeply but couldn't help anymore. Then, as I was standing in a bakery on a cold February morning, I got that call. Matt died, she said. This is my rough draft, my work in progress. My attempt to actually deal and be sad and see words on paper, to understand why my emotions conflict and how I can try to heal. Reflecting on a time in my life that seems like it didn't even happen is challenging and sad. While this is cathartic for me, I hope it helps someone. The 15-year-old that thinks they can fix it all, the 17-year-old that decides to give it one more go, and the 21-year-old who laughs when they find out about the death. These are you and these are me. There is no conclusion, no what I could have done better. Because addiction is really hard, and right when you think you've got it right, you're reminded that it's wrong. Best, Maddie. Thank you. Please join me in welcoming our next presenter, Brandon Sample.
Hello, my name is Brandon Sample, pre-law concentration, and this project is a research project based on multiracial identity. I'm continuing the work of Dr. Bruce Calvin Hoskins in his book Asian American Realities in Black and White, where he focuses on multiracial identity of Asian Black and Asian White Americans. In his book, Hoskins asks if we have entered a post-racial society due to the increase of multiracial individuals in America. Between 2000 and 2011, the number of multiracial Americans who identified as mixed with white and black doubled, and the number of Americans who identified as white and Asian rose by 87%. Hoskins uncovered that multiracial people are still subjected to what's called racial logic. Of this, he says, racial logic is necessary in order to bring together existing common sense and develop a new understanding of people of multiracial backgrounds, how they should be seen, how they should be treated, how they should be interpreted, and thus, this can be seen in the what are you question. Society still tries to put multiracial people in traditional racial categories, therefore identifying that race is still important because it determines how we ought to treat people. I conducted interviews with 8 individuals in an attempt to recreate Hoskins' studies. I asked them questions about how they personally identified, how people identified them, as well as other questions regarding racial logic. One of the limitations to my study was that I only interviewed 8 people versus Hoskins' 34. Although there was a limited sample size, I was still able to extract some valuable information from my respondents. First, I noticed that all of my interviewers developed racial logic at a very young age, or they became aware of their multiracial identity at a young age. They could all remember a specific incident that triggered that racial logic. In the instance of one of my respondents, they had just got back from a trip to the Philippines, and they were pulled over by a police officer. And the first thing the police officer asked was, what are you? You can see the police officer trying to establish racial logic in order to understand how to treat that person. Multiracial individuals such as myself and millions of others serve to blur the traditional norms of community and culture. They can belong to one, both, or none of their ethnic communities. Most multiracial people, myself included, will argue that there's only one race. But as Hoskins points out in his research, some multiracial individuals have the luxury of identifying with both, while others have a more constrained identity. The fact that multiracial people are having this identity struggle is a sign that we have long ways to go in terms of achieving racial justice, which is far more important than racial logic. Thank you. And now I would like to introduce Osman Karzai.
Hello, everyone. Thank you. Appreciate it. All right. I'm Osman Karzai, and my project is about the housing crisis in the Bay Area. How bad is this crisis? Well, California is home to 12% of the U.S. population, but a whopping 40% of America's homeless population. And the Bay Area itself is the third largest homeless population in the country, behind New York and Los Angeles. One of the big reasons is the high cost and short supply of affordable housing. The average home price in the Bay Area is $1.2 million, and the average rent for a one-bedroom is $2,700. One needs to make over $100,000 per year just to cover the mortgage and nothing else. Having spent my entire life in the Bay Area, I have witnessed firsthand the human cost of the housing crisis. Cities are covered with tents, people with jobs are sleeping in their cars, others are wandering around aimlessly with no hope for the future. While people who do own homes face 3-hour commutes because they can't afford to live near their workplace. We brag and brag about California's GDP and its strong economy. Well, this housing crisis makes it clear that we need better metrics for measuring success. In researching this project, I learned that old-fashioned individual hard work is not enough. If we want a solution to this crisis, we need to step out of our comfort zone and work together. This is a major crisis that requires a major commitment from all of us. I researched 3 groups: people on the ground, their government, and big corporations. I found that when people make enough noise by attending city council meetings, writing to their politicians, organizing protests, and sharing their stories, that government will begin to listen. California State Senator Scott Wiener, San Jose Mayor Sam Liccardo, and California Governor Gavin Newsom have made affordable housing a central plank of their agenda. They want to build millions of new homes, but also repurpose old buildings, like they're doing in San Jose, where unused schools buildings will become housing for teachers. Under intense criticism for fueling economic inequality, companies such as Facebook, Google, and Apple have all pledged billions in grants, loans, and land to alleviate the housing crisis. It shows that speaking out can make a difference. One of the main things we can do is consider fresh ideas like the Senate Bill 50, which would greenlight the building of more homes on top of each other and near public transportation and work centers. We also need politicians to create stricter laws against homeowners and their ability to raise rent, and for policies that address out-of-control economic inequalities where costs keep going up and up, but wages have remained flat, unless you're in the 1%. Overall, this crisis has steered people to demand change, but we can't be satisfied. We must do more. Thank you very much.
You.
Y ahora vamos a dar la bienvenida a los profesores de Humanidades y Comunicaciones al escenario para felicitar personalmente a los estudiantes graduados para que reciban sus certificados.
At this time, we would like to welcome all of the HCOM faculty to come to the stage in order to personally congratulate the graduating scholars as they receive their certificates.
Ahora presentaremos a los profesores de Capstone, los doctores Ernest Stromberg y Fong Nguyen, quienes reconocerán a sus alumnos. Comenzaremos con el doctor Stromberg.
Next, we would like to introduce the Capstone professors, Dr. Ernest Stromberg and Dr. Fong Nguyen, who will recognize their classes. We will begin with Dr. Stromberg.
Good afternoon, everyone. And again, thank you all for joining us in this celebration of our students' academic achievements. If we could, please, let's give them all once more a collective round of applause. Before introducing my students and welcoming them to the stage, I want to briefly express my appreciation for their work, commitment, perseverance, and courage throughout the semester. As the theme of our class indicates, we spent this semester exploring a variety of deep and painful topics, and their projects reflect that these projects range from the very private and personal to larger historical and cultural traumas. This was not emotionally easy work. We also spent time looking at the brighter side in terms of potential pathways to recovery and healing. The willingness of these students to bring their best intellectual selves to these difficult topics and to share with others some of the details of their own traumatic histories was valiant and truly inspirational. At the end, several students shared the materials we engaged. This term enhanced their appreciation of that familiar saying, "Be kind, for everyone is fighting a hard battle." And so with that, I would like to kindly invite the students from my section to take the stage and receive their certificates of capstone accomplishment. Eric Anderson. Krista Leilani Baines. Taya Bueller Reagan. Christine Daly. Harmony Sade Baje Wanyume. Christy Gardner. Holden Buchenberg. Sandra Hernandez. Elena Jolene. Shelby Leo. Jeanette Lopez. Trevor W. Nicholson. Antoinette C. Oliveras. Yaslin G. Pacheco Almodovar. Haley Poole. Alyssa Riley. Alicia Ricks. Maya Jael Rodriguez. Stephanie Maricela Rodriguez Solis. Michael Solgaard. Brandon Stettenbentz. Victoria Ashton Lazenby White. George A. Worthy. Rosa Zambrano.
As my capstone class lines up to receive their certificates, I would also like to say a few kind words for them. This was my first time teaching capstone, and luckily for me, I couldn't have asked for a better cohort of students. I'm extremely proud of what you've accomplished this semester. I'll miss you all and the impact that you've made on my life and the impact that you will make in the next chapter of your lives. You brought energy, analysis, and humor to the challenging topics of crisis and opportunity, culture and community. These very broad concepts can help us think through how social change happens. Crisis and opportunity reminds us that the enemy of progress isn't always a lack of ideas or even action, but rather a lack of opportunity. We are constantly engaged in a war of ideas, what Antonio Gramsci called a war of position, and waiting patiently for that tiny window of opportunity afforded us by crises, when, as Milton Friedman put it, the impossible becomes the inevitable is something that we have studied this semester. But it's not just ideas and opportunities, it's about building movements. I like to think of progress as a football game. If you're on offense, your goal is to move the ball down the field as far as possible. We may not cross that goal line during our tenure, but hopefully our generation gains some yardage along the way. If we're on defense, protecting the social reforms of the century, of the 20th century, we try to give up as little yardage as possible during our time. And that requires more than just individual hard work. It requires movements that are built through popular culture, social capital, interpersonal relationships, and communities, big and small. Hopefully, these are some of the lessons we remember long after this class. We had some great times in class, and there are some great projects I wish I could have engaged in when I was a student myself. And now I'd like to give our scholars a warm round of applause, or like to invite you to give them a round warm of applause as they receive their certificates. Nicholas Alderetti. Margaret Allen Young. Nicholas Caffiero. Vincent Canino. Patricia K. Cruz. Muhammad Amin Azawi Rahali. Breda Fuentes. Yesenia Hernandez. Max Height. Kiana Hughes. Nicholas Johnson. Osman Karzai.
Thank you.
Sarah Leach. Savannah McKillop.
Thank you.
Jasmine Mendoza. Kathy Morales. Katie Puentes. Antonio Ruiz. I didn't realize till later I need to slow down. Madison Randazzo. Andrew Saguindel. Brandon Sample. Angela Steele. Elena Sun. Congratulations. Marissa Tersini. Adina Vasquez. And last but not least, Andrew White.
Gracias a todos por venir al Festival de Otoño de Capstone de la Escuela de Humanidades y Comunicaciones 2019. Esperemos que hayan disfrutado de las presentaciones y la galería de trabajos.
Thank you everyone for coming to the School of Humanities and Communication Fall 2019 Capstone Festival. We hope that you enjoyed the presentations and the exhibits.
Ahora nos gustaría agradecer al personal y a los profesores de la Escuela de Humanidades y Comunicación, en especial a los profesores de Capstone, los doctores Ernest Stromberg y Phuong Nguyen, por inspirarnos y guiarnos en nuestro trayecto. Favor de pararse los profesores de la Escuela de Humanidades y Comunicación para ser reconocidos.
This time, we'd like to thank the staff and faculty and an encore of the School of Humanities and Communication, and particularly to the Capstone professors, Dr. Ernest Stromberg and Dr. Phuong Nguyen, for inspiring and guiding us through this journey. We ask the faculty and the School of Humanities and Communications to please stand and be recognized again.
Finalmente, se les agradece a los estudiantes de Capstone, los presentadores y los voluntarios, quienes han dedicado mucho tiempo y esfuerzo para preparar este evento.
And last, we'd like to thank the Capstone students, presenters, and volunteers who have devoted much time and effort in the preparation for the Capstone Festival.
Gracias por acompañarnos y que pasen una excelente tarde.
Thank you for joining us and have a beautiful rest of your day.
Congratulations. Work so hard, forgot how to vacation. They never had the dedication.